Welcome to my new series called Talk Tech with Tiff, where I am sitting down with industry professionals to hear about their career journeys and current roles. I created this series to hear from people who are established in the tech industry so that we can all learn what these individuals do in their day-to-day jobs and the type of opportunities that are out there. Okay, let's get started. Today, I'm sitting here with Lisa, who is a tech recruiter. Thanks, Lisa, for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
How are you doing today?
I'm doing excellent, other than the cold.
I know, I hear you. It is, for those of you who are not located in Toronto, it is freezing here.
Yes.
But we're making it through.
We are.
Exactly. So Lisa, to get started, tell me a little bit about what a tech recruiter role really entails.
Yeah, so I mean, anything from identifying candidates for potential roles, evaluating them against those positions, and walking them through the entire process from beginning of interview to offer stage.
Yeah, the entire process from identifying, as you said, right through the whole way of the offers. So you're with the person, the candidate, for quite a while.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it really depends on whether that candidate has approached you or whether you've actually approached them, just the style of how that rolls out.
How that rolls out.
Yeah.
Well, that's interesting. I've gotten approached by recruiters, but I've never actually approached a recruiter.
Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of people will, and a really great thing to do as a young student is to actually, you know, get your LinkedIn profile going. It's just a standard, it's one of the many places where you can meet recruiters, but really getting that going while you're a student, building out that network and actually having a network of recruiters that can support you when you do graduate.
When people reach out to recruiters, what is some things in the messaging or what should be included in the message?
Yeah, I mean, a brief introduction of yourself. If you're reaching out to a recruiter for a specific experience, giving them an indication of why you're the right person for that role. And if you're just reaching out to network, just be honest and open about that as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, recruiters love networking. It's what the industry is built on. So
yeah, it's so true. I think when I was first starting out in the tech industry, as I'm sure many people do, I almost felt scared to reach out or nervous that I was going to be bothering someone or I wasn't qualified enough to reach out. But I think at any point, reaching out is a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely. You should absolutely always take the shot.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah. And I have to ask, as this is something that goes through my mind often when I'm applying for jobs, is what makes a good candidate stand out to you or any recruiter?
For me, I mean, it's all about attitude, right? And passion is really the thing that shines through. So if you're passionate about what you do, and you're able to really look at any benchmark of accomplishments along the way, put that forward, that's a great thing.
That's a really good, yeah. So more, for example, passionate, I could show different side projects I'm working on or different events that I volunteered at or whatever the case may be.
Absolutely, yeah. Especially for individuals graduating, anything that you have done along the way that really shows your ability to stick with something and to be successful in it. So any clubs that you're involved in, volunteer activities, anything at all, like you should really highlight those for sure.
That's huge. I like that you highlighted to stick with something. I've never really thought of that before, but it does tell a story on your resume or what you've done if you're able to commit and stick to something.
100%. 100%. It ultimately ends up being the difference when companies look at individuals who have a degree versus somebody who goes to a bootcamp, for example.
Yeah.
There's that philosophy generally. That if somebody comes with a degree, they've stuck with that degree, they've walked through that process for the course of time.
So. Exactly, 4 years at least.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And then the flip side of that, what makes a candidate stand out to you in a bad way?
Oh, arrogance, definitely. And an inability to, so what I tell everybody is when you're building out a resume, read every line of your resume and ask the question, and so what? What is that telling? a potential employer? What is that telling a potential recruiter? What is the meaning of actually putting that on your resume?
Yeah, like not just filling things up to fill a page or putting things on to fill a page.
Absolutely not. What's the meaning? What? And it's three things. How have you made a company money? How have you saved a company money? Or how have you changed a process in a meaningful way within that organization? So if you look at your resume through those three lenses always, you're going to be putting your best foot forward generally.
Wow, that is such a good tip. I've never actually thought about those tips before, but moving forward, I'm going to literally write that down to do so, because it's so true and it's so simple and it really takes out a lot of the stress of should I be concluding this on a resume or should I not? But if you look at through those three lenses, it's like a checklist.
Yeah, exactly.
So Lisa, the next question I have for you here is, what advice would you give to people who are recent graduates or switching into the tech field that might have little to no work experience? I know we kind of touched on this with side projects. Is that the best way to show something?
Yeah, really. I mean, showcase anything that you have done along the way. As I said, volunteer work, projects, anything of that nature, and really like hone in and highlight that within your experience, as well as your educational experience. And I mean, if you're in graphic design or anything of that nature, then obviously bring a portfolio with you. So that is always key as well.
Yeah. One thing I get asked a lot is from the developer or designer side, if someone's just starting out, they say, Tiff, they like to get they're specific here. How many projects should I have or what should I, and this might be bad advice. I'm curious to know if it is or not, but I always say do quality projects over quantity.
Absolutely. 100%.
Yeah? Okay. Yeah. So even if there's just a few, but really good quality projects over.
Yeah, definitely. I wouldn't mar those actually by including projects that you're not happy with, because you're not going to be able to speak to them about them passionately. You have to believe in your own work in order to sell it.
You do. And it comes across like when you're speaking to someone, you can tell if they actually believe in it.
Yeah. 100%.
What would you say? I know you mentioned that you are with the candidate from the first step to the last step.
Yes.
So, and I know there's a lot to this process, but what is a typical process like?
Yeah. So, depending on whether you've applied for a position or whether a recruiter's reaching out to you, typically there would be that introductory conversation, set up a first round interview or screening, what's typically called a screening with a recruiter. And they would walk you through, you know, what you've accomplished, compensation band that you're looking for, what you're looking for in terms of your short and long-term goals. And then next rounds would be set up usually either with the hiring manager who you would report to or members of their team. But in my experience, typically you would meet the hiring manager, and then if everything goes well, you would potentially meet a couple of members of the team to ensure there's a cultural fit.
There's a cultural fit, yeah. And this might vary based role to role, but when looking for specific candidates for different roles, is there a number of potential candidates you try and have, or does that just vary completely?
No, I mean, it goes back to quality again, right? So it depends on the recruiter's approach and the organizational approach. But my approach is always, I would rather put one candidate who's the right person in front of a potential hiring manager than put three candidates who are average. Yeah. So but that comes down to, it comes down to confidence and being sure of what the individual that you're hiring for, what exactly that they're looking for. So that can take time.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I'm sure it does take time to find that right one or the potential few right ones out there.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I've looked at tens and tens and hundreds of thousands of resumes and LinkedIn profiles over the course of my career. So.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I cannot imagine. But I'm sure after a while, like anything, you learn to see what stands out and what does, and you're like, oh, this, I've seen this before. I know what this means. Or
yeah, and I mean the whole dynamic is also like the industry is being flipped from that perspective as well. Because you used to look at a gap in somebody's experience and that was a marred or a bad thing. And now, I mean, with the last 2 years of COVID, there's tons of gaps for individuals. The market has just completely changed. Yeah. And so companies are viewing gaps in experience differently.
That's so true. I never thought of that, because I remember when I was in school and making my resume, that was one of my biggest fears is, okay, how do I fill this gap here or this gap here? That's great that it's kind of changed.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I've always encouraged people, there's nothing wrong with having a personal sabbatical. If you took 2 years off to travel the world, mention that. That's actually an accomplishment. It's something that you dedicated yourself to. Your betterment is always a good thing to have on a resume, right?
Yeah, that's so true. And just being open about it. Hey, this is what I did. This is where I traveled. And I really grew from that and learned from that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
What would you say is the biggest skill or knowledge gap between people applying for the same role who have a formal degree versus people who, say, are self-taught or went to a boot camp?
Yeah, I don't, I mean, for myself personally, I don't see a tremendous knowledge gap there. There is a difference in terms of perception, because there is that perception that if you stuck with a degree for, you know, if you stuck with that education and that path for a long period of time, it shows your ability to be more dedicated. And there are companies, particularly large corporations, which tend to lean themselves in the direction of having that formalized education. Startups are a great space for people who graduate from boot camps, for example. So
I agree. I actually, so I have a degree, but I did a 180 and wanted to get into coding. So I went to a boot camp and I found that my first job was at a startup for that reason, because it was a really great way way to enter the industry, absolutely, gain that experience, and then from there be able to apply to more of the big corporations.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It's a really good entry spot, particularly for people from boot camps.
Yeah, I agree. And startups are fun. You know, they're a great environment, great people. It's good.
Absolutely. I think everybody should experience startups. But I also think that you, so from every environment that you go into, learn something while you're there. Have a story when you leave it. Even if it was a bad experience, leave with something that you've accomplished and you can storyline to your next potential employer.
That's so true. I love how you say story, like make it a, bring a story. I've never thought of it that way, but yeah. I feel like people are more engaged in stories and they can actually kind of picture your journey as well with a story.
Absolutely. And I mean, having interviewed, you know, tech and non-tech individuals over the course of my career, like it is something that I've strongly encouraged, particularly individuals in tech. They don't always think of it as a storyline, right? They're talking about their experience in their coding, but how do you position that to a potential employer? And exactly. So, yeah, you're marketing yourself always.
You are. And I think a lot of, I don't know if it's a lot, but there definitely are some when it comes to technical people, they just think, oh, my skills will speak for themselves. And that's great, but you also need those soft skills and bring those personable skills because you're working on a team.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So, and that can be challenging for people, right? Like not everybody's a brand ambassador, right?
Exactly.
And particularly individuals are often shy in terms of actually talking about, I did that, I accomplished that. Yeah. And so it's, you know, your resume and your interview, don't hold back, brag, don't overshoot, and don't be afraid of saying, I don't know.
Yes. Oh, I love that. It's so true. That was once my biggest fear when I would go into technical interviews is I have to know everything. And then I realized as I got on the other side and was interviewing others, I was like, if you don't know, just say you don't know, you know, just be honest and explain your thought process. Why, what are you stuck on exactly? Why don't you know this? Or, and work collaboratively with your interviewer. But it is scary.
It is. It's terrifying.
I know. I feel like interviewing itself is a skill or something that you just have to keep on doing to get better at.
Absolutely. You can build that over the course of time, and it's great to put yourself out there, have those conversations, mess it up, and be okay with that.
Yes.
Just evaluate after the interview. You know, I really could have handled that question differently, or I could have gone in that direction. Yeah. That's a learning for your next interview.
Exactly. Learn from your failures, or I wouldn't even call them failures, but from those experiences.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
So what has changed in the recruitment process since COVID as more people are working from home?
Yeah, so what's really changed during the process is the pushing and the strong introduction really of the video interview and how people position themselves in a video interview or on an interview by camera. It's really, it's challenging. And I think as recruiters, you have to be conscious of that when you're taking individuals through the process for sure.
Yeah. So I know for some interviews, they're done in group settings. And I have had friends who've had to do virtual interviews with others, like a group interview. And I just think to myself, the challenges that would bring to stand out virtually in a group interview is just...
Yeah, it's really... I mean, I've always thought panel interviews are very, very challenging. Mm-hmm. That ability to split focus, making sure that you're covering everybody in the room. And it's a distracting process. I do understand it's very valuable if you're having anybody who's going to be presenting on top for the organization or selling for the organization. But it's an intimidating process to be in a panel interview. And certainly, to stand out within a panel interview on video takes a lot.
Exactly. Lisa, for anyone, I know we were speaking prior to this interview about how you came into recruitment kind of organically, just... but for anyone who is looking to get into technical recruitment, what is some advice you would give to them? Is there more formal processes they should do now? Can they just get in through experience, or what would be the best way?
Yeah, I mean, you can get in either direction. I mean, you can go, do a degree or courses in recruitment and HR and get in from that perspective. I would say to anybody wanting to get into technical recruitment or be a subject matter expert, I've now seen technology individuals flip into recruitment.
Oh yeah,
definitely. I think for recruitment, you really have to be a very strong researcher. You have to be dogmatic and dedicated to what you do. You have to be passionate about what you do, essentially, at the end of the day.
Yeah.
But yeah, you don't need the formal education, but it's always a value to have it.
It is. Yeah. And even other things that come from formal education, just time management or communication, or the list goes on.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, last question I have for you. What advice would you give your younger self?
Oh, wow. That's an interesting question. Travel more.
I love that. Yes, I agree. I agree. That's perfect. I agree. So for anyone listening, travel more. Go travel.
100%.
Lisa, thank you so much for being here. It was great to chat with you. I feel like I gained so much insight as to what to do and also what not to do when applying for jobs and also to just reach out to recruiters.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me. This was really fun.
Thanks, Lisa.
All right. Take care.